Hello, my name is Daniel McLaughlin, and I'm a consulting engineer with Jamf, and this session is titled Offboarding with your IDP and Jamf. As this is a pre-recorded session, questions can be asked during the presentation via the QA panel within the browser window. In this session, I'm going to cover the following: what the thought process is concerning this topic. I'll be showing you how to achieve a couple of different end results using Octa and Azure as my IDP, and what end result do we want for our devices to be in when this action is triggered. I will then be demonstrating the communication via API from Octa and Azure to Jamf School and Jamf Pro. All of my sample code will be available via the link at the end. So let's jump on in. So before we get started with the where and hows of this, let's first talk briefly about the why. In the last few years, the device location and ownership model has changed across many organizations. And while the last thing we think about when we receive a shiny new device is when we won't have it anymore, it's still a workflow that, if not carried out correctly, can lead to a loss of assets or proprietary information, from something as innocuous as an employee directory to highly sensitive content such as source code. These methods of offboarding is often thought of when an end user is forcibly removed from the organization, but it extends to a much wider scope, such as in education, when students graduate, or devices that are coming to an end of their life cycle and the user is getting a replacement. The old hardware still contains information and has monetary value to the organization. How can we in IT ensure that that data is protected? This presentation will cover the scenario of when a user is no longer a member of the organization and the methods of how to automate tasks based on this event. When we discuss automation, it's important to tread carefully, as it is a double-edged sword, and if not planned or implemented correctly, rather than saving you time and energy, can cost you a lot of late nights, if not worse. So we first need to factor, what devices do we have? Are they macOS or iOS or both? Who owns the hardware? Do we have automated enrollment? Do we know what the state of the supervision is on the devices? And of course, what is the end user experience? For example, let's say your directory team have a security setting in place that says a user becomes disabled after 5 failed password attempts. If your automation was to automatically wipe the device once a user becomes disabled, you're going to have some awkward conversations with that end user who just came back from leave and couldn't remember their password. If your organization is comprised of macOS and iOS devices with full ownership, automated enrollment, authentication required by pre-stage, you may decide to go for the hard and fast wipe rule. This may work for your organization, but not for everyone's. It's important to factor what the possible scenarios are. The last thing I'll call out for planning of this is the username format. When talking about IDPs, the username format is often their email. However, within Jamf, the device may be assigned to their short name or SAM account name, especially if you have a hybrid environment. As such, your code may be required to build the username from the email or from another source. In my scenario, the IDP uses email, but the device assignment shows as username. As such, I've added into my code to remove all text after the at symbol. So daniel.mclaughlin@jamf.com becomes daniel.mclaughlin. The first IDP I'll show you is Octa, specifically leveraging Octa workflows. For a more in-depth presentation on Octa workflows and Jamf, I recommend you watch this year's JNUC presentation titled Automating Device Lifecycle with Octa Workflows. So within Octa, there is a user deactivated event that will occur, which initiates the workflow. The workflow will then trigger an API call to either Jamf Pro or Jamf School to get all of the devices assigned to that user. From that request, the workflow will then cycle through and take the action on those devices. In my scenario, all iOS devices are supervised and will be set to loss mode, but you can change this to be a wipe or any other supported MDM command. As for the macOS devices, I'm leveraging Jamf Connect, and I have two different configuration profiles configured, one of which is denying local login, so network authentication via the IDP must be used, whereas the current scope profile allows a local login. In order to trigger the change, I'm having Octa Workflows submit via the API that will automatically move the macOS devices into a different group, where the more restricted Jamf Connect profile is scoped to. You can, of course, adapt this to be a lock or wipe device, depending on what your requirements are and what commands are supported. So let's see this in action. The event triggers and contacts Jamf Pro or Jamf School via the API, and then responds back with the list of assigned devices. From here, it then goes through and then contacts each of those devices appropriately. We see the iOS device will be put into loss mode, and the local login button disappears on Jamf Connect. So let's see what that workflow looks like. Octa workflows can be very powerful. For the purpose of this presentation, I've tried to keep as much as possible on the top level to make it easier to see. We can see within the workflow console, I have set up two, one for Jamf School and one for Jamf Pro. Each of these talks to a child flow dependent on macOS or iOS devices. So let's look at them further. We can see that the Octa workflow has a lot of native functionality. There are more advanced ways of achieving some of these steps, but I wanted to call out some of the logic here. As you read the flow from left to right, you will see the fields will show as linked, which you can do by dragging and dropping. We can see the first tile I have is the Octa user deactivated event. I'm taking the Octa user ID from this event and passing that through. However, as I mentioned, in my environment, my devices are signed by username, not email. So I need to split the Octa user ID based on the at symbol. So to do this, I use the next pane titled split. From there, I take the first item of the split pane. The workflow then sends that to the concatenate to the Jamf URL. In this case, appending the username to the Jamf Cloud URL. We then do a raw API request to that URL, which is getting all of the devices assigned to this user from your Jamf server. We return the JSON body of this request and parse it, build that to a list, which is then sent to the child workflow to action each device either by loss mode, wipe, etc. So let's see how that looks. We can see the Octa user ID is then linked through to split, again, by dragging and dropping. The result of this is then sent to our first item. We then send that through to join the Jamf URL. We then take that response of the URL to the raw request. So this is where it will then make that request by the API to get all of the devices. We take that request body, put it to a JSON parser, and then from there, send that to a child flow, the list of those results. One thing I should mention is, since making this video, Octa has announced a specific Jamf Pro API connector, which would replace the API connector raw request. Again, for more information on workflows, please watch the session Automated Device Lifecycle with all Octa workflows. Now let's see it happening live. I found for the purposes of this presentation, it was easier to demonstrate this on iOS. Within Octa workflows, there is a useful test button, and I've inserted what the sample JSON object structure would be for this event. You can see the flow of actions as it takes the object data, splits it, joins it, before then making the Jamf API call to get this user's devices, which then cycles through a child flow of each ID to post the loss mode. It all happens quite quickly, so I'll run through the video again. Go to our test button, very useful. I'll scroll down and we can see there's my JSON with my ID, daniel.jnuc@jamfse.io. We have the green ticks across the board as it sends through and the device is in loss mode. Very useful for testing, happens very quickly. Just run that one more time. Daniel.jnuc, my username. So I need to split that off and then send that through. Now, let's see how we can achieve this with Microsoft Azure AD. Within Azure AD, we have the ability to forward audit logs to what is called an event hub. And then by leveraging Azure functions, we can execute actions based on an event hub trigger, after which the Azure function will parse the message, take the appropriate action. In our case, we will look for the disabled user event, and then query Jamf Pro or Jamf School to get all the associated devices with that user. After which we will send respective commands to macOS devices to prevent login with Jamf Connect, and for iOS devices to move to loss mode. As mentioned before, you can change these commands to anything that conforms your organization's requirements and what the API supports. In addition, you could leverage this same workflow for other events, such as user membership changed, to then send an update inventory command to the device. Let's see what this flow looks like. The event occurs in Azure AD. The log is then sent to the event hub. The event hub is then triggering the function app, and the function app will then execute the API requests to Jamf Pro and Jamf School, send responds back with the list of the devices assigned to that user, at which point then the actions to each of those devices. For iOS, putting it to loss mode. For macOS, we are changing the configuration profile. We can see it might have been a bit slow on the last one. The local login button on Jamf Connect is going to disappear. Lost mode for the iPad or phone, and local login is now unavailable. So let's have a look at what this looks like within the Azure console. In this video, I'm going to be creating everything from scratch, copying over the code. If you want to see how to create an Octa workflow, then again, I strongly recommend you check out the JNUC session, Automating Device Lifecycle with Octa Workflows. So in order to send Azure audit logs to the Event Hub, we first need to create a resource group and also an Event Hub namespace. So let's do that first. We go to the Event Hubs, create, and as part of that creation, we can also create a resource group. I have also sped this video up for the sake of time. Once that creation is complete, we can go to the resources that have been created. So we'll click on the Go to Resource button, and then Event Hubs on the left-hand side, and we'll create a new Event Hub. Once this Event Hub is available, it will be available within the Azure audit log as an export destination. So we go back, we go to our Azure AD, audit logs, export data settings, add. We are going to give this a name, audit logs, and then stream to an Event Hub. To confirm that the data has been sent from the audit log to the Event Hub, we are going to go to the Event Hub itself and process data. This is very useful for testing and validating what an object appears and how the log looks. When we do our test, because we have only just created this, there's going to be no data in there. Now that we have the Event Hub set up, we can create a function app and attach it to this Event Hub. For this example, I'm going to be using a PowerShell-based function app, as it would allow me to edit the code within the console. If you wanted, you could write this in Python. However, you would be required to use Visual Studio in order to write and submit the Python code to your function. So we'll select our PowerShell core and our location, review and create. This deployment can take some time. Once it is complete, we will go to the function app itself, functions, and then we will click on the left-hand side for functions and we'll go create. We are going to pick an Azure Event Hub trigger for the Event Hub. And since this is a new Event Hub connection, a new connection will need to be made. So just click on the new link, give it a name, and we'll go create. From there, we can go to the code and test on the left-hand side. And from there, we have some default code provided. I will copy and paste my example code that I have. And if we follow the path, we can see once an event is received, I am looking specifically for the disabled account event. After that, I am splitting the user's email to be their short name, and then querying Jamf Pro to find all devices assigned to that user. You see, target UPN. There's the query, splitting out based on computers and Mac OSs, and then for each of the iOS devices, cycling through, and for each Mac OS, updating. I'm updating extension attribute because this is a Jamf Pro, but you could change this to be an MDM device lock command. And for each iOS device, I'm putting the device into lost mode as my devices were supervised. Here is an example of what the raw JSON looks like for a disabled user event. There is a large amount of data that is provided, so we'll need to parse it accordingly. You may also notice as well that some fields are nested. And here we can see within the disabled user event, what the target resource is, and what the user principal name is. And if that's the user identifier in Jamf for the device, then proceed up. Otherwise, use the information of the UPN to create the username before contacting Jamf Pro. And now let's see it happening live. Now I should mention there is a delay of about 5 minutes from when the event occurs in Azure to being registered and triggered by the function. In some of my tests, it was less than this, and it was never more than 5 minutes. So I've set a stopwatch on the device to run as soon as I hit disable. Naturally, this has been sped up. So we go through, we find an information from our HR that a user is no longer within the organization. So we're going to go to that user's record. We're going to edit. And we're going to block login, which is disabling the user. I've kicked off the stopwatch on here and it will be timing up. From this point, the audit log is triggering. So whenever a user is enabled or disabled inside Azure, that is going to the audit log. That then will then stream to the event hub. From the event hub, we'll trigger the function app, and the function app will then run the script. And there we go. The device is now in loss mode. Again, depending on what MDM command you have and how you've configured it, could be a full wipe, could be lock, you know, with a message. If you've got macOS devices, it could be a full wipe as well. Or if you just wanted to change the user's membership in here, that also triggers in the Azure as the audit log, and you'd send an update inventory. If you'd like to know more, here are some useful links for getting started. The first being the Jamf Developer Portal that has API links to Jamf Pro, Jamf School, and Jamf Protect. For more information on Octa workflows, you can go to help.octa.com page. And as I've mentioned several times before, please check out JNUC session Automating Device Lifecycle with Octa Workflows. It is going to be a great session. For more information about event hubs, you can see this link. There's lots of documentation on Azure Functions as well on docs.microsoft.com. And finally, that jamf.it link is a redirect to my GitHub repo, where my example functions can be found, along with a text file with the following links and any additional information I can think to add. And with that, thank you for watching this session.